Chris Sewell here, baseball card collector, investor, dealer, in that order. Welcome, everyone. Today, I'm going to do something a little bit fun, at least fun for me. I used to be in the film industry, sort of on the production side. And today, I'm going to look at some film and TV shows that feature baseball cards or sports cards as part of their plot. You know, we've never had like a feature film or a major TV series about baseball cards or sports cards. I don't mean like a documentary. I mean like a fictional film or TV series. Hopefully that comes at some point. That would be fun. But they have been, you know, featured in various episodes and somewhat relevant to the plot in certain movies. So I'm going to look at three of them here today and become like a film critic, way overanalyze it, be super annoying about it. And looking at it from like a sports card perspective, like did they get the details right, that sort of thing. So I will definitely find this very, very fun. Hopefully you do as well. All right, first one we're going to look at is Better Call Saul, which is a TV show. It's been running for about 5 years. I think it just wrapped up, and it's the prequel to Breaking Bad. It's a fantastic show about drug dealers and criminals. And there's an episode where a sort of nerdy engineer gets sort of mixed up with some of these drug dealers, and he has his baseball cards stolen. It's a very, very valuable collection, and it's important that he gets these cards back, so they sort of work it out, and then they figure out a way to get the cards back. And this scene is him getting his cards back.
Okay, there's Jeter. Mantle. There's Mantle.
We good?
Yeah, that looks like everyone. Yeah, they're here. Looks like everyone's here.
All right, so it's a very short scene, but a couple of issues with it. First of all, the collection is supposed to be extremely valuable, and secondly, the character is supposed to be a baseball card, you know, expert or connoisseur, whatever you want to call it. That's how it's explained in earlier scenes. Well, this is just not what a valuable collection by a savvy collector looks like. It appears to be a bunch of junk wax era cards, late 80s, early 90s. Obviously, I don't know that for sure without seeing every card, but that's what it looks like. Doesn't look like there's any sort of sets or anything. And nothing's in sleeves or top loaders. Everything's just loose in the box. And he, you know, this character mentions in an earlier scene in the episode that, you know, talks about how you're supposed to protect your valuable baseball cards. And if you had an original Mantle, an original Hank Aaron card, you wouldn't just leave them loose in a box. Again, this just isn't what a valuable collection from a savvy collector looks like. Quite a boo-boo here from the research department on Better Call Saul. They should be reprimanded accordingly. And next, if you really wanted to nitpick, it looks like I got about 6 four-row boxes, which is roughly 20,000 cards. He went through that in about 15 seconds and concluded that everything was there. You know, I know what it means to be fast assessing collections, but that is a bit of a reach. All right, next is the film Cop Out, which came out in 2010, starring Bruce Willis and Tracy Morgan. And actually, a baseball card's featured heavily for the plot. A very, very valuable card that Bruce Willis owns gets stolen. And then they basically spend the whole film trying to track down the card. Here's where we get introduced to the card early in the movie.
What's with the box?
I gotta sell the craft card.
I heard that. I know that's right. I'm lying. What's a craft card?
It's a baseball card.
Baseball card? Jim, listen, if you need 20 bucks, I...
I don't need 20 bucks. Selling it to cover my daughter's wedding, all right?
So, how much is that thing worth?
Well, it's a gem mint 10 Andy Pafko, 1952. The Topps Gum Company came out with the first modern baseball cards. Andy Pafko was number one, first card in that set. Kids would collect the cards, right? And could stack them up, wrap rubber bands around them. My father never wrapped any rubber bands around his card. Loved Andy Pafko. Always took good care of him. About 4 or 5 years ago, he sold one of these gem mint 10s at auction for about $83,000.
$83,000?
Yeah. My daughter's wedding's gonna cost $48,000.
You're about to come off like a fat rat in a cheese factory, Jim.
Yeah, that's if we get 80.
All right, so let's pick this apart for fun. First thing of note is this is clearly a reprint. Now, I'm going to kind of give them a pass here, as the I'm sure it didn't make sense for the props department to go out and buy an original 1952 Topps Andy Pafko and High Grade just for a few seconds of screen time. So no biggie there. They did get the details right on this card. It's a very significant card. 1952 Topps card number one, the very first card in the very first standard Topps baseball card set. And Andy Pafko, he was a solid player, but he's long forgotten, never made the Hall of Fame or anything like that. So he's sort of an obscure player to have such a valuable card, which sort of, you know, I think adds to the story. But the real inaccuracy with the scene is, of course, that the card is not graded. He said a gem mint copy sold a couple of years ago for $83,000, and that's technically possible, but it would have definitely been in a PSA 10 holder. And if it went for $83,000, you know, nobody on the planet is going to pay $80,000 for a raw copy. It doesn't matter how perfect or nice it is. Nobody's paying that, and it would have to be in a PSA 10 holder. So he's going to the store in this scene expecting to sell it for $80,000. That obviously would not happen. Now, I was kind of curious if that $83,000 sale he mentioned was based on a real sale. I actually think that it may have been. I went on the PSA Pop Report. The card is just a Pop 1 in a PSA 10, but I could not find any information. I couldn't find anything about a sale. I could not find an image of the card or any details. So I don't know if that was true or not, but it's believable. This film came out in 2010, a few years prior. Yeah, it's possible that the Pop 1 Andy Pafko back then sold for that much. And quick side note, in addition to being a Pop 1 and a PSA 10, there also exist 09s and 08.5, so it's the only copy graded higher than an 8. And out of the flashback scene from the 1950s, the rubber band story, that's spot on. Yeah, kids used to put their cards in rubber bands, and because they'd put the card in cards in numerical order often, and then the cards on the top and the bottom often got hit the worst with the rubber bands, and those are often the hardest to find in high grade. Andy Pafko's card number one, so that's one of the reasons that card in particular is impossible to find in high grade, and why a PSA 10 might actually sell that high. But on the flip side, I don't know what cards these are. These definitely cards shown here are not from the 1950s. I don't even recognize them. They look like maybe they're even like homemade or definitely more modern than 50s, so research department gets in a little bit of trouble for that one with me, as that would have been very easy to just go out and buy a bunch of 50s commons and make the scene a little more authentic. All right, and third one we're going to look at is This Is Us, which is a beautiful show. Still, I think it just wrapped, and it's definitely a tearjerker, so if you're going to watch it, bring a box of tissues or two. This scene is just, there's just one episode that features baseball cards. One of the main characters is named Kevin. Present day, he's about 40 or so, and these are flashback scenes to the early 90s when he's remembering going to a baseball card store with his mom.
Hey, you got any 91s left, Carl?
Ooh, not many. What are you looking for, Kev?
I need a 91 John Candelaria to finish off last year's set. I got 10 bucks to do it.
Well, I've got only 16 packs left, but I like your chances of finding it.
Great, I'll take them. Thank you.
$8.40.
No John Candelaria? No? Well, buck up, sweetheart. You have what, 14 packs left? Blow on this one. Good luck. Oh gosh, this gum is really not very good. The flavor only lasts a minute. You gotta replace it like every 60 seconds. I feel good about this one. Yeah, come on. Hey, bada swing. Come on.
And then the flashback continues later in the episode.
Which I know you probably think is a bad thing sometimes. Maybe people don't take you seriously.
Let me try. Ready?
And then at the end of the episode, Kevin, now present day and, you know, 40-ish years old, goes back to a card store. Sure.
flowers in the vase that you bought today.
All right, so whoever was in charge of the research department for this show, I thought was spot on. I thought this scene was incredibly authentic. One of the more authentic baseball card scenes I've ever seen in a movie or TV show. The store, so this is taking place in 1992. That's exactly what this looks like. The pennants are from that era. I can see on the shelf, I can make out 1988 Donruss boxes. I can make out 1987 Topps football, 1989 Topps baseball rack packs. Those would have all been perfect for the era. The 1991 Topps box is definitely authentic and an original box, as are all the packs and the cards, and I can only assume the gum. Casting-wise, I thought this guy was the perfect baseball card owner. I'm glad they didn't do, you know, a caricature like the comic book guy from The Simpsons who's super jerky. Most card store owners are very nice, and I thought this guy, you know, for only being on screen a few seconds, totally nailed it. And then if you go back to the display case here, you can see vintage cards in the display case. They didn't screw up by putting any modern cards post-1992, so I think the research department gets 5 stars here. If you really wanted to nitpick, you could say it was a little weird that Kevin walked in and said, "Do you have any 1991s left?" He would need to say, "Do you have any 1991 tops left?" As there were a bunch of brands in 1991, so he wouldn't just say, "Hey, do you have any 91s? But that's a nitpick, like I said. And they even got the price right. 16 packs cost $8.40. That would have been 50 cents a pack plus 5% sales tax. That's, again, spot on. But that's it. Some scenes from movies and shows featuring baseball cards or sports cards. I guess these were all baseball cards, but there's actually a lot more movies and shows that feature this. So if people enjoyed this, I can do one of these videos every once in a while. But hope you enjoyed. I really did. And see you all again soon. Thanks, everyone.